Lanier v. Minnesota was a landmark Supreme Court case on the subject of freedom of the press. The First Amendment was the grounds the case was initially argued upon, and it reads as follows. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble, and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. The First Amendment was ratified on December 15, 1791, as a part of the Bill of Rights. The case of Near v. Minnesota, on the other hand, was decided on June 1, 1931, in a close 5-4 decision. This overturned the Minnesota legislation, known as the Public Nuisance Law, of 1925, on the grounds of being unconstitutional. The origins of the Public Nuisance Law, also known as the Minnesota Gag Law, dwell on the rise of a newspaper published by John L. Morrison known as the Duluth Ripsaw, published in its namesake, Duluth County. The Duluth Ripsaw was a blend of sensationalized news and scandals, all designed to point out the flaws in key public figures. In Morrison's issue published on October 25, 1924, he made claims against State Senator Mike Boyland, who Morrison claims had threatened to kill him should he ever write an article about Boyland and Ripsaw, in which Morrison replied that he promised to take the senator across the editorial knee and give him a good spanking. Morrison also made claims against Bert James, the judge of Cass County, as to having syphilis due to sex at a brothel 27 years earlier with a young girl, and against Victor Power, the former mayor of Hibbing County, who was running for Congress on a platform involving prohibition, who Morrison said was corrupt and a drunkard. All three men filed lawsuits against Morrison, intent to keep him jailed and unable to publish his newspaper. These cases began in 1924 and continued until 1926. As the cases against Morrison continued into the next year, Senator Boyland used his power and the help of prominent newspapers to petition Minnesota Congress to pass the Public Nuisance Act of 1925. This act stated that any person who, as an individual or as a member of an employer firm or association or organization, or as an officer, director, member, or employee of a corporation, shall be engaged in the business of regularly or customarily producing, publishing, or circulating, having in possession, selling, or giving away, an obscene, lewd, and lascivious newspaper, magazine, or other periodical, or a malicious, scandalous, and defamatory newspaper, magazine, or other periodical, is guilty of a nuisance, and all persons guilty of such nuisance may be enjoined as hereinafter provided. Ripsaw was not targeted by the gag law until 1926, in which Morrison accused the mayor of Minneapolis of adultery. After that article, a warrant was put out for his arrest, and the Ripsaw was shut down. Yet, before his arrest, Morrison died on May 18, 1926, from a clot in his brain. If Morrison had not died, it would have been likely that he would have taken the public nuisance law to the Supreme Courts. However, that was evidently not meant to be. Instead, in 1927, Minnesota saw the beginning of a publication known as the Saturday Press, a scandal sheet run by J.M. Neer and Howard A. Guilford. Neer's views that he populated the paper with were largely anti-Catholic, anti-Semitic, anti-black, and anti-labor. Guilford, on the other hand, was a former mayoral candidate with a previous conviction of criminal libel under his belt. The Saturday Press published its first issue, in which it accused Police Chief Frank W. Brunskill, Mayor George E. Leach, and Governor candidate Floyd B. Olson of working with and actively refusing to prosecute Jewish gangs. Shortly after this issue's printing, Guilford was shot and then hospitalized. Other actions taken against the newspaper was a filing against the Saturday Press by Olson under the Public Nuisance Law of 1925. In the local courts, it was ruled that the Saturday Press constituted a nuisance and was able to be silenced by the Public Nuisance Law. However, Neer and Guilford were determined to fight the ruling and took their case to the Minnesota Supreme Court, in which not once, but twice, was the ruling of the local courts supported by the Minnesota Supreme Court. In the first proceeding, it was ruled that the abuse of free speech could pose a danger to the public good and could incite violence. In the second proceeding, the ruling was based off the fact that the law did not prevent an individual from starting another publication that was meant for the public good. Neer alone decided to take the case all the way up to the Supreme Court, which had just undergone some significant changes. Chief Justice William Howard Taft and Justice Edward Sanford had just died. Taft's court was majority conservative, yet the two new justices, Owen Roberts and Chief Justice Charles Evan Hughes, did not spell a definite success for Neer. Justices Owen Wendell Holmes and Louis Brandeis would most likely side with Neer, while four other justices could be counted on to side with the gag law. The case was scheduled for April 26, 1930. Oddly enough, during the court proceedings, Minnesota attempted to repeal the public nuisance law. However, the House's vote to repeal was blocked by a failed vote in the Senate. On June 1, 1931, as previously mentioned, the case was decided in a close 5-4 vote against the public nuisance law. This was decided based upon the 14th Amendment. All persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. At the conclusion of the case, the Public Nuisance Law of 1925 was deemed unconstitutional and forcibly repealed. After this, Guilford continued to involve himself with yellow journalism, joining the staff of the Twin City Reporter, in which he continued to draw the ill will of gangs in Minneapolis. This resulted in him being shot and killed on September 6, 1934. The case of Neer v. Minnesota did very few things for the formal freedom of the press, but the things that it did achieve were very significant. The key achievement of the case was in the application of the 14th Amendment in the general political realm. In this instance, the 14th Amendment further increased the power that the federal government had over state governments. The First Amendment had only protected freedom of the presses from federal laws, not state laws, and the concept of state laws taking advantage of this loophole had not yet been seen. Neer also determined the political viability prior restraint, as exhibited by the public nuisance law, as in preventing companies from printing publications based on court rulings. As determined by Neer, prior restraint is only constitutional in times in which speaking out against the government could be a potential danger to national security, such as in wartime. As for society as a whole, the press didn't get much of a leg up. Yellow or investigative journalism continued to be disliked, as evident by Guilford's unfortunate demise. However, publications such as Duluth Ripsaw were picked up by other companies and still published under the same name. Big newspapers printing anything about politicians could still get hit with a court case as well, such as the case of New York Times Co. v. Sullivan. This case occurred in response to a paid advertisement speaking out against Southern politicians about the frequent arrests of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The advertisement was titled, "Heed Their Rising Voices," and brought notice to the focus Southern aggressors had at removing Dr. Martin Luther King from the civil rights movement. City Commissioner of Montgomery, L.B. Sullivan, took personal offense to the statements issued in the advertisement and filed a libel lawsuit against the New York Times and several prominent black ministers involved with its writing. The New York Times lost the lawsuit as they could not prove that the claims made in the advertisement were factual under the Alabama law. However, the Supreme Court found, citing Neer v. Minnesota as a part of its decision, that the First Amendment protects all statements, truthful or not, as long as the statements are not malicious. Finally, there was no observed cultural change that occurred as a result of the Neer ruling. As previously mentioned, a general culture against yellow journalism remained prominent at least up to New York Times Company v. Sullivan in 1964, with Alabama's libel law allowing for people to file charges without having to provide evidence that they were wronged by the publication. The issue of prior restraint can be seen most obviously today through the actions of our president. Quite recently, 7 people sued President Donald Trump on grounds of him infringing upon their First Amendment rights by blocking them on Twitter. Not unlike the public nuisance law of 1925, blocking an individual on Twitter limits them from publishing their ideas to you specifically, restraining their ability to spread their ideas. Now, blocking someone on Twitter isn't a huge deal normally. However, last month a judge ruled that the president's tweets are a public forum for people to share their ideas, and blocking of the plaintiffs based on their political speech constitutes viewpoint discrimination that violates the First Amendment. In the end, the ruling of Neer v. Minnesota resulted primarily in the deeming of the concept of prior restraint unconstitutional and the asserting that the 14th Amendment meant that just like the federal government, state governments cannot infringe upon free speech as granted by the First Amendment, and that truths and lies were protected under the First Amendment as decided by New York Times Company v. Sullivan, which used Neer in its decision.
Now I ask you very confidently, ain't she sweet, ain't she nice? Look her over once or twice. Now I ask you very confidentially, ain't she nice? Just cast an eye in her direction. Oh, me, oh, my, ain't that perfection? I repeat, don't speak that kind of neat. And I ask you very confidentially,
kiss her in the rain, rain, rain.